Hi everyone, thanks for tuning in to today's Curator's Talk, which will be looking at the Royal Navy photographs that were compiled by Arthur Onslow and are in what is known as the Macarthur-Onslow album. The album came into the library in 1957, and as a photo historian, I believe it holds some of the best examples of early Australian and Pacific photography. But before we get started, I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which the library is built, the Gadigal people, and to pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. I'd also like to note that some of the photos we are looking at today are of unidentified Aboriginal and South Sea Islander people, and given the age of the photographs, they are of deceased people. While the photos are not central to today's talk, I'd also like to acknowledge that they may be of cultural significance, and as they remain mostly unidentified, I'd welcome any feedback which may help in further identification of the individuals, and I'm more than happy to share any research I have relating to these photos. These two pages give an indication of the very content contained in the Macarthur-Onslow scrapbook, as well as images by Arthur Onslow. It contains works by a veritable who's who of amateur photographers working in Sydney at the end of the 1850s. These include John Smith, Robert Hunt, Matthew Fortescue Moresby, Edward Wolstenholme Ward, as well as the work of professionals like William Hetzer. The ramshackle nature of the pages, with hand-cut and unmounted albumen prints pasted next to lithographs, original drawings and copies of popular artworks, has the appearance of many other photographic scrapbooks compiled by gentlemen amateurs from the period. As you can see, the photographs on the pages vary as much in size and shape as they do in subject matter, and many are likely to have been prints which were exchanged within the amateur group. They were mostly made between 1857 and 1865, with a few later images, like the unveiling of Captain Cook's statue, dating to 1879. Some are clearly topographic views of Sydney, some are from the goldfields, others are of more domestic family scenes, such as fashionable homes in Sydney. The richness of the content in this scrapbook allows for any number of possible discussions, but today I'll be looking at the naval photographs, which form one strong narrative thread that flows through the album. Importantly, this thread also emphasises the role of Arthur Onslow in the compilation of the scrapbook. But before I start, I also need to note that certainty is always difficult when researching old photographs, and I'm more wary today about attributions than I was when I started down this road some time ago. Sometimes knowledge of people and places can help, but even when the content is clearly identifiable, attributions can still be difficult due to cropping, incorrect captioning, lack of dates, confusing formats, and later copying of vintage prints. Given the complexity, variation, and significance in the works in the Macarthur-Onslow album, I'd be foolish to consider this talk as anything but touching on the surface of this remarkable historic artifact. If anyone would like to follow up with questions or information relating to the photographs, please feel free to contact me. I'm always happy to talk about old photographs. To illustrate the complexity surrounding identifying photographs, I'd like to introduce the one image that is not from the scrapbook. This depicts Arthur Onslow and the rest of the crew on the HMS Herald, taken around 1860. For many years, this has appeared in articles about James Glenn Wilson, another photographer on board the Herald, and listed among the works of held by Captain Denham, who was captain of the Herald. In it, we can see the names of the crew members, some of whom boarded the ship with Onslow in 1857. Originally credited to the photographer James Glenn Wilson, this is now thought not to be the case, as Wilson left the ship in 1859, a year before the date of this image. This second image is from the Macarthur album, and while it looks remarkably similar at first glance to the earlier photo, it's clearly a different picture. In this picture, Arthur Onslow is now a central figure standing directly behind the captain, Henry Mangles Demon, and he's surrounded by the crew members that were on board with him from 1857 to 1861. Given that the photo was no longer thought to be by Wilson, I wondered if it was perhaps a professional image taken as a memento by the crew. This is a close-up of the earlier photo, and on close inspection it became clear that in fact this is a composite picture made up from a number of prints which have been cut out and pasted together. The rigging was also drawn onto the print, which was then re-photographed. And given this, it seems likely that it may have been a number of photographers whose portrait work had then been carefully cut out and pasted together to create this print. And given the central role both in the image and the scrapbook more generally, it seems likely this may have been done by Onslow. But, and I guess this is the point, it remains hard to make any kind of definitive statement, as without first-hand accounts or annotations, these remain best guesses based on the research available. This is a picture of the HMS Herald in Farm Cove, taken around 1857. You can see Pinchgut in the background there. And it's a great starting point for this talk for images relating to HMS Herald or to the voyages that it's made, sprinkled throughout the Macarthur-Onslow album. And it's also the ship that Lieutenant Arthur Onslow boarded when it was recommissioned in 1857. The Herald had actually been in Sydney since 1853, where it was undertaking surveying work in Australia and the Pacific for the Admiralty's Hydrographic Office. She was a 6 or 8 wooden sailing ship with 26 guns, and by the time Onslow arrived, she had made voyages through Vanuatu, the Solomon Islands, Fiji and Tonga. And by the time it returned to England in 1861, it had completed one of the longest surveying missions ever undertaken by Admiralty, and Onslow was a crew member for all of its last voyages. There was a second vessel that left England with HMS Herald in 1852, and it was part of the surveying mission. This was a paddle steamer, HMS Torch. It was commanded by Captain Chimo, and it was hoped that the steamer would be of use around reefs where the sailing was dangerous. As it turned out, the problems with finding fuel and the lack of seaworthiness of the ship led to being sold in Sydney to private parties in 1856. This is a beautiful photo of a paddle steamer which was in the album. And while it looks very similar to HMS Torch, and a view that we have in the library of the Torch painted by Conrad Martens in 1855, again looks very similar to this, it's not possible to say whether it is definitely the Torch, but given that it's in the album, it is possible. This is a lithograph from the Macarthur-Onslow album, and it's one of a few lithographs that are pasted into the pages. It's by James Glenn Wilson, and it depicts HMS Herald, HMS Torch and HMS Serpent in Sydney, probably around about 1853. James Glenn Wilson was the artist on board the Herald, but also uniquely, he was also a photographer, and the Admiralty actually had provided Wilson with a calotype camera and chemicals to take photographs, which he then sent back to the Hydrographic Office along with the Herald's charts and documents. While we know these were warmly received in early 1855, as of yet no photographs of Wilson's have been positively identified, although there are a few in this album which could be contenders. One of the problems was for Wilson was access to clean water, chemicals and paper on the longer voyage, and a second was the complex nature of the process, particularly fixing the print to ensure it didn't fade. It seems likely that he actually made this sketch or drawing in lieu of taking a photograph, and in many instances I'm sure that it would have been easier for Wilson to do a drawing or sketch than it would have been to have taken photographs. It may be that he actually didn't take a lot of photographs, and that's why they're very rare, hard to find. The sketch of Sydney Harbour, which we think may be made about 1853, is dated because that was when the Serpent under Captain Hammett arrived after a tour of the Solomon Islands. Arthur Onslow was appointed lieutenant on HMS Herald in 1857, and he arrived in Sydney in April 1857. This list of photographic materials, which was ordered for HMS Herald in November 1857, is just before Onslow was making his first surveying trip with the Herald. And it's clear that Wilson was no longer using the calotype process. The list of chemicals here is for creating collodion emulsion used on glass plates, and these produced a clearer, more clinical results than those made with paper negatives. Wilson would leave the ship in 1859 and become a surveyor for the New South Wales government. But for the next year or so, Onslow and Wilson were both taking photographs on the Herald's voyages. On the 21st of December 1857, Onslow left Sydney on his first tour with the Herald. In February 1858, the Herald arrived at King George Sound in Western Australia, where Onslow and Wilson took some of the first views of the area. This stereoscopic photo of the harbour was taken using a single lens camera and appears to have been taken by either Onslow or Wilson. Although there are no naval photographs in the scrapbook, which seem to predate Onslow's arrival in 1857, it is possible he either learnt to take photographs in England or even from one of the many amateurs active in Sydney at the time. But it is likely, however, that however much he knew prior to this voyage with the Herald, he must have learnt from Wilson, as according to Onslow's journal, he felt Wilson was a much more successful photographer than he was. This photograph of the town of Albany in King George Sound also appears to have been taken during the Herald's stopover. Albany was originally a military outpost named Fredericktown, and in 1832 the outpost's name was changed to Albany. By 1858 it was clearly a fairly well established town. This photo of the London Hotel in Albany is one of the larger prints in the scrapbook, suggesting it was taken using a different camera from the one used to create the previous stereo views. Onslow's journal states that on at least one of these picture-taking expeditions, he was taking portrait photos of the local Menangnunga people while Wilson was taking views. And given the size and competency of the photograph, it's possible that this is one of those taken by Wilson. This photo is one of a series of images in the Macarthur-Onslow album, which are possibly the earliest photographs of the Menangnunga people of Western Australia. These appear to have been taken in February 1858, but in this case with a different lens from the previous views. The blurry background suggests a shortened depth of field, so it may have been taken using a portrait lens. I'd also like to note that in this and the following Aboriginal images, the sitters are currently unidentified, and we'd welcome any further information which may help in identifying them. These two photographs are of an unidentified Menangnunga woman and an unidentified Menangnunga man, also from King George Sound, Western Australia. These two images have been annotated and appear to have been taken on the same stopover by the Herald, but the quality of the images is quite different. This could be due to them being taken by different photographers, or perhaps even by different cameras. Interestingly, photographs from King George Sound are found on a number of different pages, and this lack of a consistent chronology or annotations or even similar photographic subjects on the scrapbook's 150 or so pages have made it difficult to bring together some of the narrative threads, like the photos taken in King George Sound, as they are spread throughout the scrapbook. After a short stopover in Sydney from the 30th of June to the 3rd of September, the Herald set out on its first Coral Sea cruise up the coast of East Australia. It appears that this photo of unidentified Kwandamuka people seated in front of their dwellings on Moreton Island, Queensland, may have been taken around November 1858, as this was when both Onslow and Wilson landed on Moreton Island with the surveying party from the Herald. There are several photos which appear to be taken around this time contained in the album, and these are likely to be among the earliest photographs of Kwandamuka people taken. On the 19th of December 1858, the Herald returned to Farm Cove in preparation for a longer Coral Sea cruise. Onslow used this time ashore in Sydney to visit the Dumeresque family at Tivoli in Rose Bay and also the Macarthurs at Camden. And over Christmas, he appears to have taken images at both locations. When looking at this photograph, I was struck by the resemblance of the man lying on the lounge to Onslow. And on closer inspection, it does indeed seem to be a picture of Arthur and perhaps Elizabeth with the dog and cat at Camden. When Onslow arrived in Sydney, HMS Iris, a gunship from the Navy, was also in Sydney Harbour. But rather than doing surveying duties, the Iris was sent on voyages to monitor European interests across the Pacific. She was also engaged in punitive trips in Vanuatu and in the Solomon Islands. At this time, at the time this photo was taken, she was sitting in Farm Cove, and the date of the image is around about 1857, and it may have been taken around the same time as the earlier picture of the Herald. This very early photograph of Tanner in Vanuatu was taken by Matthew Fortescue Moresby, who was the paymaster on HMS Iris in 1858. It's actually a contender for one of the earliest photographs taken in the Pacific Islands that is extant. There are other similar copies of this in the Maclay Museum with the Robert Hunt collection, and it's clear that Moresby exchanged photos with other amateurs, and this is presumably how it ended up in the Macarthur-Onslow album. The two stereoscopic images hand cut and pasted onto the page. They haven't been mounted, and you can see there is a slight difference between each frame, indicating that it was taken on a single lens camera. The photograph was also taken on a creek bed, presumably to improve the amount of light and therefore lower the exposure time, as this was a difficulty for early photographers, particularly taking photographs in dense wooded or jungle areas where there wasn't enough light for their cameras. This stereo photograph, which was taken in August of 1859, is of members of the Herald's crew erecting a beacon on Mellish Cay on the east coast of Australia. Over the course of 1859 and 1860, the Herald had focused its surveying voyages on the dangerous reefs which lay along the eastern coast of Australia, and the charts they created from these voyages vastly improved navigation for sea traffic to the Torres Strait. But one of the issues was the lack of visibility of these low-lying cays, and one solution was to erect a tall structure or beacon on the island which could alert the ships to the danger. But as most of the cays or reefs were devoid of wood or suitable stone, the Herald's crew, under the direction of Denham, decided to erect a beacon using the remains of a French man of war, the Durack, which had been wrecked on Mellish Cay in August 1856. This image is almost certainly by Arthur Onslow, as by this time James Glenn Wilson had left the Herald's crew. This stereo photograph of the beacon on Rain Island, again off the eastern coast of Australia, was taken in March 1860 and is almost certainly by Arthur Onslow. On the 20th of March, the Herald sighted Rain Island and this distinctive red and black beacon tower, which had been constructed in 1844 by Commander Blackwood when the HMS Fly had stopped there. The Herald's crew spent a few days repairing the beacon and refreshing supplies of food and water for ships or crew in distress. After this, Captain Denham asked Onslow to photograph the beacon. On the 16th of August 1860, the Herald finally left Australia on its return trip to England after nearly 9 years away. On the way back, the ship passed through Table Bay at Cape Town in South Africa and was there in February 1861. And this is perhaps when this image of the harbour was taken. Again, we can't be certain if it was taken by Onslow, but it is certainly the date is about right. After Onslow returned to England, he studied navigation before serving on HMS Phaeton, which was stationed at the North America and West Indies Station from the 31st of October 1861 to 1863. She was a wooden sailing ship of 50 guns, and this image of the Phaeton was taken in 1861 while she was in the harbour of Halifax, Nova Scotia. It's unclear whether it was taken by Onslow, but again, it quite possibly could have been. There are a number of images of Matamoros, Mexico, contained in the scrapbook, which suggest Onslow may have visited this Mexican seaport sometime around 1862. This is quite possible as the Phaeton was at Veracruz during this period. Matamoros was radically changed after it declared itself an international free trade zone in 1858, and this resulted in the expansion of their Baghdad port. Commercial interest in the town was at its peak in 1862 when these photos were taken, as it had become an important port for cotton exports from the Confederate States of America during the Civil War, which had broken out in 1861. This stereoscopic image of Matamoros appears to have been taken by Onslow on a single lens camera. You can see the different position of the foot of the person entering the door. In March 1863, the HMS Phaeton arrived at English Harbour on the island of Antigua, and Onslow was certainly on board the Phaeton at this time. This harbour had been Admiral Nelson's base in the West Indies during the Napoleonic Wars, and it was during this period that new buildings were completed and the wharves and fortifications extended. After this, it was referred to as Nelson's Dockyard. The yard was closed in 1889 and abandoned until 1951. In this picture, we can see HMS Phaeton in the background with a person posing in the centre of the image. The Phaeton arrived in Bridgetown, Barbados, with Onslow on board in June 1863. And this amazing photograph of Tudor Street was probably taken around the same time. Given the lady in the dress in front of the cart is in the right frame but not the left, it's clear the photographer again was probably using a single lens camera to create the stereo image. Onslow may have taken this image, but as Bridgetown was a thriving town at this time, it's possible he either exchanged it with another amateur or purchased it from a professional studio. In 1863, Onslow was promoted to the rank of commander and appointed to HMS Meany, which was stationed in the Mediterranean. But unfortunately, he only spent a short period of time there as his health failed, and after gaining 2 years sick leave, he returned to Sydney. Once here, he caught up with many of his old friends from his time on the Herald, and in particular, he became reacquainted with Elizabeth Macarthur, who we can see here in this photograph on the left with her mother, Emily. And obviously they got on well, because in 1867 they were married, and Onslow spent the rest of his life here in Australia and died in 1882. So it's a pretty remarkable story. Obviously crammed a lot of into his fairly short life. And while I haven't had time to show you all the naval images posted into the scrapbook, I think they do lay out a good case to see Arthur Onslow as the central character in compiling the naval photographs, and perhaps by extension the many other extraordinary images in this remarkable collection. So thank you very much for tuning into the talk. See you later.